Signing Signs was the first project. So, and if you look at the album cover, that was our rehearsal hall. Album cover of Signing the Times is where we rehearsed. Paisley Park wasn't finishing, just for a little bit of trivia, so you know that. So anyway, we would spend 6 days a week, 12 hours a day, going over and over on these songs. And the way Prince would rehearse, he would say, okay, there's X amount of songs on the record, we're gonna do 3 songs a day. And what that meant is you have to learn your principal part at the time. That was bass and vocal part.
Hello,
and he would tell each person to learn their part. The next day, at 11 o'clock, he'd go 1, 2, 3, and it better sound like the record. Okay? If it didn't sound like the record, we got a problem. And a couple people tested him on that, and he cleared it up right away.
Uh-huh.
Next time I count it off, and you don't know that part, you're going to be on the next flight
smoking. Celebrating Prince's Sign of the Times.
And then when we went on tour, we filmed every night. That's another thing with Prince. When they say what's in that vault, I know. Okay? Just in my time to imagine every concert
from the
NPG he's ever done is on video somewhere. And recording. And the albums, and the outtakes, and the remixes. It's crazy. So hopefully whoever's in charge of this thing is like decades great music to be released. And I'm telling you, some of the stuff I heard in there is better than anything you've ever heard.
Yeah. Okay. We're getting ready to watch the movie Sign of the Time.
Do we have any other questions? Clay, come on up.
They said you were one of the 1,000 great guitar players. I think you're more like one of the top 10. I don't know, even better. I know a little bit about music, amazing your ability. And so my question is, you as someone who's already a genius, who's already like top tier musician, what's something that Prince did that you looked at and you were just like, whoa? You know, like, do you have a moment in the studio, you saw him do something, you saw him write something, play something, or whatever, that made you, as someone who's already a genius, feel like, what just happened? You know what I mean? Like, something he did musically, like, on the guitar, or, like, with his voice, or something like that, that just made you say, wow.
Well, there's a lot of moments like that, but I'll tell you, the first thing I was impressed with was the first album, the intro. Have you guys heard it with all the voices? And he talked to me about that and said it took him a long time to do that. And I'm like, wow, how did you hear all of that? And it shows you, to me, sometimes I think Prince has already been here.
Yeah.
Anybody met somebody and you say, I think you've been here a couple times because you're too good at that. You know, but I'll give you a story. Some of you have heard the story. Diamonds and Pearls album.
Yeah.
So, we finished the record. We went to Warner Brothers, did a showcase, right? And like a showcase like no other. You know, Warner Brothers, it was like a 6-story building. They had 400 employees. And it was unannounced. We didn't even tell the employees we were coming, right? So here we pull up, and the employees, like, they don't even know we're there, but they can feel something. They're like, something's going on today. And then they go and they sniff it. They're like, I smell vanilla. It was Prince. So, let me tell you, ladies, we ain't got nothing on Prince. You know how you get in your room, you spray on or something?
Yeah.
Prince would buy the 100% perfume from Prince.
Yeah.
If anybody's ever had some of that, you can put a half a drop on and it lasts all week. And Prince would drench himself in that, okay? So he walks in the building, goes up to the fourth floor, and everybody's sniffling, oh my God. So we put on this, it was lunchtime, and we had it all set up, the stage just like now, and we performed for all the employees to get them juiced about the Diamonds and Pearls.
Oh my God.
But here's where I'm going to the incredible thing. So it was off the hook, man. So we get home, me and Prince flew together. We get back, and I get a call from Mo Austin, who's the president of Warner Brothers at the time. It's like, Levi, we got a problem. I'm like, yo, we just left there, man. He said, man, we don't have the first single. We have a great album, but we don't have the first single. And I'm like, why are you calling me? I don't write Prince's checks. You write his checks. Why don't you call him? Yeah, but y'all cool, man, you know? Y'all cool. So I had to tell Prince that his album wasn't finished. Okay, that's one of a thousand things that I've been through with him. Okay, and so he's in the studio working on the Symbol record.
Right.
He's already working on the Symbol album, and so I'm coming in there. I'm like, Prince is like, what's wrong with you, man? I said, man, we gotta talk, man. I said, hey, you know, we just did a great show of Warner's, but I got a call from home. We don't have a first single. He's like, no way, that's not, man, we're done with that record. And then, you know, of course, you know, he's got an ego.
Yeah, yeah.
So Chris is the only man in the world that I think it's okay to have an ego, because he's the best.
Right.
Okay, so anyway, we go back and forth for 10 minutes. I said, Chris, man, they want the first single. And then I left. Okay, it was about 10 o'clock. He calls me at 5 in the morning, right? He says, come back down to Page. I'm like, really, at 5 in the morning? Because he works all the time. So I come in, and he says, sit down. And he's tired and everything, and he says, hit the button. So I hit the button, and he had written Cream in one night. And when I say written, I mean produced. And 70% of the arrangement is there. So he told me, tomorrow, set up the studio, we're gonna have a band come in and replace the parts that I did and finish it. Right? And anyway, long story short, I sent it to Mo Austin, and he said, yes, Levi, we're done.
Hello, Gaga.
And it was number one. That's the genius of the man that you know. We got one time for one more question.
We have time for about maybe one more question. Tanette, come on up.
Tanette. Okay, so I work as an old field here, right? And I do synopsis.
Make up.
Just an apple synopsis. Do you hear me? And you hear me now? Already there.
Y'all are welcome.
What's your question? You're talking low. What's your question?
I'm not scared. What happened to his old costumes? That's a great suit. Some really cool costumes.
They're somewhere. But what I'm gonna add to that is I think it's important that you guys know this. You know, Prince was also a fashion icon.
Yes, yes.
Come on. And I want to share this with you, then I'll tell you where our office are. So, you guys may have seen this one suit that Prince wore. Matter of fact, we're on the surface, it kind of looked like a circus suit. It had colored lines that went from the top all the way down. And let me show you the detail that he went into. So, first of all, Prince had a staff of 6. I call them the wardrobe elves, for lack of a better phrase. And they just make costumes and shoes all day long.
Oh my God.
So anyway, I was up there, and Prince, they had finished this, I call it the circus suit. He said, it's not right.
Oh,
you know, they spent countless hours on the suit. He said, it's not right. And they're like, well, what's wrong? So he put the suit on, and he wanted the line from his jacket to run
straight
all the
down.
Way
yeah.
to the line on his pants, down to the line on the suit.
Go, Prince! Go, Prince!
Yeah. So imagine a red line going from your shoulder, down your arm, down your leg, and down the suit. Okay, they have to have that kind of detail. Yeah. So anyway, there are thousands and thousands of outfits somewhere in Paisley Park, and they're all in cases. We had the best designers in the world. And they were very frustrated because Prince would always change them. You know, he hired the top guest, you know, he started blinking those eyelashes. Can we do this? You know? Can you take the buttons off? And I forgot the fashion designer who had all the buttons. One of the guys got some pants on tonight. He was very famous for buttons. Yeah. And Prince was like, can you take some of those off? Can it be this color? And they just like, dude, that's my vibe, man. You messing it up. But they would do it because they respected Prince for all that he does. So anyway, all of those outfits are in manual cases in the basement of Penn's.
Oh, wow.
Also, Prince has a lot of storage units. So as well as music, there's memorabilia, all kind of stuff. You cannot imagine all of the things in Prince's world.
Oh.
You can't imagine.
Spill the tea.
So. It's the real last question, because I know we all be going to get back to some funk, for real. This is what's up. This is my East Bay homie, by the way, you know. Yo, man, you kicked it with Prince. He's one of my true, true musical heroes. But I really want to know, when y'all was chilling, doing the damn thing, you know, the late night chill, I want to know what Prince listened to. What did he bump? What music was he playing? You know what I'm saying? That's what I want to know. What love?
That's a real good question.
The best, let me start like this. Prince respected great music. If it was great, I don't care if it was country, classical, whatever it was. If it was great, he was listening to it, and he put it in the purple blender. I'll tell you, like when we do our sound checks, 3-hour sound checks every day, but we have like an hour or two before the show, and if you walk past Prince's dressing room, you're going to hear the Franklin classics, you're going to hear James Brown, you're going to hear some Led Zeppelin.
Real music.
He loved Patti LaBelle, you know, they were very good friends. Jazz artist Stanley Clarke. Every genre of music he would listen to. He wasn't really into like things that were a hit on the chart. He didn't care about that. I don't care if it's number one. Either I like the song or I don't. Either I hear the music in it or I don't.
Yeah.
And if you notice, like his music has stood the test of time. And I'm not going to make a difference between, like, I love Michael Jackson and Prince, but when Michael died, I was like, wow. My next thought was like, if this happened to Prince, how would he be received? Because Michael, when he died, seemed like everything was shut down for 3-4 months.
Yeah.
Even Barack couldn't get on TV. Barack was on the ticker tape, right? And so Michael had the popularity and all of the money, but Prince's catalog, they haven't scratched the surface on that.
Right.
Okay, they don't even
know.
That's why I was watching all of the everything that's going on with the family and the state, because I've been in the world. And let me say this one last thing, Gigi. So let me tell you how many songs are involved. Anybody went to college before?
Yeah.
You know, they take the size of their biggest minor, and then take four of those. Like, this thing, it's four minors, and on each page, there's 25 songs. That are not just, you know, with acoustic guitar on a cassette, I'm talking about recording. Okay?
Wow.
That many binders with that many songs per page, and they're recorded and half mixed in the bar.
Oh my God.
And I said, Chris, what is this? He said, oh, go on the bar, look. He said, just pick something. I had an engineer bring it up. And I'm like, you did all of these songs? He's like, yeah, man, I do like 2 or 3 a day since he had his record deal. Okay? So that bar, listen, if we can help him anyway, with advice or anything, or like, you know, moving Prince's music in the right way, I want everybody to participate in that, because that,
yes.
I'm telling you, this is treasure in there, and it's going to bless all of you.
Yes.
I'm telling you, the best Prince in there. Anyway, thank you. Oh, you know what? I want to thank Gigi. Come on, give it up for Gigi. Yeah, y'all are welcome. Thanks for having me, and let's enjoy the film.